So it's kind of hard to come up with questions for everybody because y'all are going to have a multitude of experiences. And I also want to recognize that not everybody on this stage might identify as queer. And that's okay. That's y'all struggle. But what I do want to highlight is that queer fan spaces are normally deeply diverse, but queer media often has not been. And there's kind of like an old fandom truth that, like, once you have queer fans, you can do anything.
We were little baby dykes, like wandering around, like trying to figure out what to do, and just like basically the blind leading the blind, and there was no place for us to go for support or help or anybody talking about the things that we were going through. And so I kept saying we need something like this because I needed something like that. Like my friends needed something like that. And what began to happen, this gives me chills off, it makes me tear every time, sorry, y'all. But what we started getting was like these emails. Parts of Africa and the Midwest, and all of them fucking said the same thing, which is that the show made them feel less alone. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And having people who can say that and to know that we affected someone's life or heart, or for some of them, they literally said we saved their life because it gave them some space where they felt like there were people in the Middle East who were telling us that they were hiding in condemned basements to sneak and be able to watch the show online. What you let me know is that I'm not speaking into like an echo chamber, and that what we do, even little things that we thought were little things, because this is just something I thought that me and my friends, like it, the show was basically The View for queer women, except we had no Hasselbeck and we drank a shit ton of wine. You know what I mean? But we talked about things that were real to us vulnerably, you know? And I think that every space that we show, we see images of ourselves, just us being, is a resistance. Mm-hmm. I truly, truly believe that. And I feel like most of us who are out often could not suppress it, because I think that there's a lot of people that have that spark of light, that spark of something in them, whether it's queerness or something else, that makes them not typical for other places around them. And those of us that it is undeniable, so we have to just stand in it, give space for those people to choose their spark instead of choosing their shadow.
I mean, I want to continue to pass this down, but I was trying to find that quote from Viola Davis about how what representation means, and if you can't see it, you can't imagine it, and how important it is to see yourself, to imagine a possibility of your future. And so I actually kind of want to maybe have two questions on the floor now, just what has queer fan spaces done to help boost your feeling of being seen, and what it means to you to be able to be a representation to so many folks, be it here or just abroad.
Look, in Brazil, we didn't have a lesbian web series at all, and we have soap operas in Brazil. They are so popular there, and
she learned it's Portuguese.
But soap operas are so conservative, and then the lesbian couples are like. all I talk. And then in the high moment of them are like, one kid's like, you know?
Or a hug.
Oh my God, they kiss. Community and the lesbian people there, please. And so our series talk about love, talk about the real love. And this was amazing. We have a lot of stories about people that can be able to explain to the family what is the feeling about. And then we have a lot of women talking to us about thank you because you make it possible for me to explain my family that what I feel is something that you need to respect because it's a thing. It's not a phase. It's not something that you have a story talking about that. So, and another, so many stories about health, about lonely and stuff. And
so it's nice to connect what you said, like, because the internet is so powerful. Mm-hmm. And then, because our show is not on YouTube, unfortunately, but it's on Vimeo, so on demand, it's not so easy to everyone have a sex, which. So. But we became to receive this DM like from India, from Russia, from and I was like, oh my God, but you know, you're going to stay. It's so amazing. So it was a big surprise, big nice surprise.
But
of course we are not on YouTube because a lot of I cannot just say this and don't explain. Because for us to make this possible, we need to have this kind of thing because on demand will help us to create the next season. So
yeah.
That's what the queer community did for us. You know, they helped us to build the show. And this is amazing. And then I can do my art, I can do the feel of what really means to me. And I can see that what really means to me can really help someone and mean something for the other person. And that's the magic.
Inspired them, like they inspire me, and you know, and as I had shared on day one, like I didn't realize the full extent of Sophie when I first auditioned. I didn't realize that she was going to be the love interest to Kate Kane until after I had booked the job. So then once I had, and then they were like, okay, we're gonna bring in a whole storyline with your mom because you're closeted, but your mom is super conservative, so you gotta be able to this and that, whatever. I didn't realize like the impact of that until like I started talking to people, and then I was even like kind of DMing some black queer women who were actually sharing with me their stories of being closeted. And so being able to tell that story, I mean, it's like even to this like second, it touches me so much that it felt like an honor to be able to do that. And so, you know, in some aspects, you know, I mean, I've always just let it just be like, hey, I'm an actor, but obviously, you know, when Javisi had come on, like it made me feel like, oh gosh, like because I'm not queer, like is that gonna be an issue? And are people even gonna wanna listen to Sophie's story? But today, from speaking to the GOAT community,
hey.
I mean, just knowing how much she's like impacted you guys, like it just, it's so important. And then the fact that they've got a whole campaign going on right now to keep the show going, like, it's like the fan impact is huge. And so it's just been one of my greatest honors to be able to tell this story, truly. And I'm sorry I'm not a part of the community, but I always say I'm very friendly. See you outside. I'm just kidding.
Allies exist. Allies exist.
Yeah, and that are necessary.
Really, really make Nora and that each our cat that there are no queer people here. Like, if like, hang on.
I do my best to represent the friendly group. I see Teresa looking at me right now. Oh, I just gotta kiss the vessel.
No, we love our friendlies.
I just have to say that as there is a representation, you finally start to see characters that aren't just like one thing or the other. And for myself playing Nikita, who's not like necessarily the good guy in this show.
She's complex.
But I think it was just a joy to be able to be like, okay, I can play a human being and I don't have to be good or I don't have to be just that. I can be all these nuances, because obviously in any community, to be queer, disabled, black, white, anything, there's going to be all shades of humanity in there. So I can see that as progress when we're starting to actually see full humans and multiple experiences of queerness and multiple experiences of all those things. So that's what it's meant for me. And then to see that resonate with people is just honestly gorgeous. So, yeah. How fucking blessed am I to have so much under my belt that is all queer. I am playing queer characters, I'm playing non-binary, I'm playing asexual, I'm playing characters that need representation, and holy shit, I am blessed. I'm not like a big name yet, but I'm gonna get there, and I feel like I'm getting there through the underdog way. On top of that, I recognize with the ability I have to be vulnerable and speak from my heart, if I may be vulnerable in regards to this question, I deal with a lot of mental health, depression, ideation. Oh, being vulnerable is really scary. But it's important because people see themselves. Mm-hmm. And since I've been able to use my platform for being a huge advocate of mental health, I have had people reach out to me and say that I have helped change their lives because they are being seen and they're not alone. And if they're having a really dark day, I have like people reach out, or even I reach out. People recognize when I don't post on Instagram for a while that maybe something's wrong. And people reach out, and I'm able to reach out to them. So being in this community and having the queer fans so much more than just being queer. We are a huge community, and I feel extraordinarily blessed to be a part of that. So thank you.
I have so many follow-ups to everything that people said, but I have ADHD, so you know. And so I want to ask just one more question before we bring it out to the audience. On the stage is such a mix of different kinds of creators, different kind of artistry, and a lot of you all have really good pioneers education. It was the priority. You know, we're going to make sure to do better. And slowly but surely, we started to see how cheap that promise was. So many of the shows that people love and adore in this space have faced cancellation over the last 12 months. Mm-hmm. And now, you know, there are campaigns to try and save these shows. But I'm wondering if for the folks who are generating content, what's been something that's really helped create that sense of ownership, create that sense of, if nothing else, we have to create the representation for us in the world.
I don't know if I totally understand like your questions, I'm sorry, but I think red is an example that this is possible because I think it created really good panorama to make the show. Because in Brazil we don't have the culture of crowdfunding. It's something really difficult to happen. But we had the Brazilian crowdfunding and also the internet because of the fans around the world, because the internet is really powerful. We could have the crowdfunding here as well. So then we could produce the show. So if you watch the show, like the first season, it's really, the production is not good. You can hear audios. It's so nice. Like, yeah. And also the camera, just a small Canon camera, you know. And then we evolved a lot because we could make the show. And then the main thing was a way that we could improve, because otherwise we would not tell the story. Yeah. Because we know, like, come on, you guys are here in Petro, you know, you guys are the internet. That's everyone always says that, I'm like, that was mad. So, you know, it's so nice because you're on Netflix or it's a movie or Amazon, like big place to happen with movies, and we are on the internet. And not because of this, because we don't have the sponsor. So, but the guys, they really think in a good way. Like the guys from our show, the producer, the director, is the same.
Our fans are really like our producers. They are the producer.
Yeah. The fans. And so I think it was a really good example that it's a way to create your representation. Is it for you?
No, no,
absolutely it is.
It is.
You did that. Yes. No. Yes.
They're usually watching YouTube, but there's some stuff that they do watch that they really get into, and it's like a lot of my stuff, I tend to, like Cherry Bomb was one of the first streaming shows that was a half hour long on the internet, period, right? When people didn't always have enough bandwidth to even do a lot of watching it, they had to spend time to download and all that stuff, but they still made it, right? But that's like was 10 years ahead of the time when most people were willing to watch streaming. So a lot of the stuff that I've had ideas for is sitting there, but it was about 10 years before its time. And so it's like getting those things in, and the more that you guys demand things from them and write in about these particular characters, that makes a difference too. So it's like us continuing to have the fortitude to keep making work, even though it's challenging, because it is, like it's challenging, it hits a wall, when we're getting notes, we're like, we can feel this, and if other black, brown, queer people read it, they're like, oh my God, this is what I have been like, I just want to see this. And then if you send it to a cishet white gatekeeper, a lot of them read it, they're like, what? And why is she doing that? And why would they ever be like that? It's like, just trust me. Trust me, I know. You know, and so it's like us being able to keep doing that authentically, and y'all keep demanding it authentically, and keep demanding campaigns. Like when you see even like a little character, like start writing them, highlighting it, because when they start, they don't get it, but they do get that. They get that.
I'll just say really quickly.
Yeah.
I said this whatever day it was, Friday. Just remember, guys, like you know, we still live in a very like capitalistic nation. And so,
dismantle that, but that's a whole
big time. And so for me, it sadly was not a big surprise when all of a sudden, you know, all these corporations, TV shows, whatever, this and that and the other, all of a sudden just kind of like died out. You know, they really tried to take advantage of, you know, the George Floyd era, if you will, and BLM, and, you know, they act like they care, but they don't. And you have to just like remember that.
Yeah.
It's all about the money, which is really, excuse my language, fucked up.
Yeah.
And personally, I think because we allow money and marketability to drive things, we're kind of losing the humanity of a lot of this shit. And a lot of people are getting ignored and neglected, and just literally everything. And so I just feel like it's up to us as human beings to continue that advocacy, to continue the message. We can't let it be upon these people like these big wigs, because at the end of the day, they really do not care. I mean, they canceled Batwoman on Lesbian Visibility Week and Superhero Day. They don't care. So just don't be surprised when stuff like that happens with, you know, corporate America now all of a sudden not caring a year later, because it's just about the money and it's not a big deal now. You know, so, but it should always be a big deal, like here in your heart, and then that's why you, that's what drives you, not what they care about. That's what I'm going to say.
Projections of your experience into the writing and how different the two are.
You should.
You know? Because it was, let me just say, looking at the Batwoman Twitter, it was clear that we were there. It was clear, and that felt good. But then when you look at, you know, like some of the other characters you play, I could also tell that we weren't there. So yeah, I'm just curious for everyone on stage, but especially for you, Megan. Or that we
I'm still, now this one I am bitter. I'm still working through all of it, because it's just so, it's really sad for me personally, because I actually had to tell myself on this experience with Batwoman to just try to not care, but it's so hard, because in like my soul, I care so much for proper representation of even just a black woman.
Yeah.
You know, like what she would really do when she's sitting across from Kate Kane. Like there was a scene that they just, I didn't like the way they had written it, but then speaking with the showrunner, who is white and lesbian, it was her personal story. And so I understood that, you know, she wanted to see her story, you know, in Batwoman, and I get it, that I was actually playing her coming out So I can't diss that. However, you cast a black woman in the role. And so it just ticked me off when there wasn't really just proper representation. And then I didn't really find that our writer's room was very, very diverse. I mean, it was diverse in the way that we actually, there was half of the writer's room actually really was queer. So that was wonderful.
And they spent a lot of time looking for queer writers for that, actually.
Yeah, like, and that I think was awesome. But there needed to be, some black queer women or just,
we're right here ready for
yeah,
you.
I mean, yeah, we're right here. So, yeah, it was a little tough. And then really quickly, because I want everybody else to be able to speak, but it also was difficult, too, because I saw that they may not have exactly known how to raise up two black queer characters on the show. Because as soon as Javicia came on, and I always say it, I love her to death, it has nothing to do with her, they just did not know what to do with me. So it was quite frustrating and annoying, but we just need more people like the Goat Gang to get into the room to help these types of things. Yeah. Yeah. That was my PG Nice version. Don't hire an actor and then have them teach you and not pay them, because they're doing your job for
it's
you.
It's a second job.
Yeah, wow. It's another job. So in my experience, a lot of that is just kind of wooing and also being mindful of my own energy. Because, you also have to work in these spaces. You don't want to be the bad guy, as whatever. No matter how sweet and kind you can be about it, you're still the bad guy. We're so angry. Wow, why? Why are you angry? But I think a lot of that just comes back to a lot of the things we've been talking about, supporting each other, being there with each other for those conversations.
Yeah, she was so intimidating. Why are you being so aggressive? But like having someone next to you who's like, no, I see what she's saying too, can sometimes be really helpful. And it's not to say, and I don't, because I know there's folks probably watching in the interwebs that sometimes you can't afford to pitch a job, or to say, to speak of it that way. Like sometimes you got kids at home, you got a mortgage to pay, that doesn't allow you that flexibility to be able to speak up in that way. So sometimes we have to give support in other ways. I just want to acknowledge that, because I've had places in my life where I, you know, I had to do that. I had to listen to, you know, this woman make racist jokes to her mother next to my cubicle for like a year, you know, and my ex-husband quit his job over that. I was like, well, then who's gonna pay the rent? Do you know what I'm saying? Like, it's there's things that we deal with and that we figure out what we can stomach and what we can't. We find where our line is, but the more allies we have, the more helpful it is. Just like you, the same thing like you were talking about, like, we do need allies. We need people in whatever group is considered most adjacent to whoever's in the power structure. Yeah. So like your proximity to straightness allows you to advocate for us as queer people in a way that people can't always hear it from us. You know, so like that privilege you get from that can be used as a tool to uplevel everybody else. And in the same way, like I may have like education privilege over somebody else because I've got like a couple degrees, right? My family's had generations of education. So somebody that's being pushed down or marginalized around class or education, I can stand up for them and I can say something that speaks out for their humanity and their value and their worth and calls people out on undermining that because they don't hold the same things that I hold. Like we all have something that we have a privilege of that someone else doesn't have that we can use to stand for them. If we all start doing that, they're fucked.
In Brazil because of their behavior and racism and all shit I saw that was normalized for all people. Like everybody don't know I need to work so I have to, no, I can't be here. I can't, this is not right. And I think my privilege begin when I can't say that, and no, you will not, I'm not allowing you to say that to my friend or for anybody here because of your power. And I think it's so difficult because people need their jobs and it's a kind of when you start to talking and with powerful people about this kind of stuff, and you lost your job actually because in Brazil we don't have enough this sense of collectivity yet, I think, in the business. So it's very tough, and I agree with you about the art and what my actress work are serving. Why am I here? Right? Why? It's for vanity or for money or no? It's because I believe in something. So that no makes sense to stay in the cast that the director put the casting down, you know, or do something worse. So that was I think about that, and it's very. We are all so many things, and I have I perform a white woman, and no, doesn't matter what I feel about all the stuff. I am not like a person that suffer racism, for example. So I can't just cannot tolerate when I saw this. I think that's it. That's my job, I think. I don't know. I am learning to how to serve for the things I believe. So I think we are all learning how to, courage to put your opinion there. And it doesn't matter. I'm an actress, but I am a human being, and you need to respect me. So that's it, I guess. And to tell this story. So, I don't know if I'm totally answering your question.
I have an ex who used to be like I love romantic comedies and stuff like that. They make me very happy. And he used to always be like, those aren't real, the endings aren't real. He'd be like, they aren't, that's not a real story. Like, he's very into, like, more indie films or whatever. not that the endings aren't real, it's where you choose to stop the movie, right? So a romantic comedy or like a romance would have stopped the movie in that moment, like, oh, the relationship is not over, you know, it's gonna turn to something big. An indie film would have stopped it like years later when we're getting a divorce.
Right.
Right?
Uh-huh.
And so like those are the different, that's the choice we have, is that we can lean into going from the harsher kind of usual more indie movie ending, or going from each joyful ending to each joyful ending, because life keeps going after the ending, but we can choose which ending we lean into, so that when those down moments happen, we're leaning into, yes, that's a down moment, but that's like act two of this part of my life.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not the climax or the end of the film. And that's how I do it, which is probably because I'm a writer and an actor, that's a part of why that made sense to me, is like, I can choose which part I lean into. I can choose which part I put the weight on. And that's what I choose. That's what I consistently, and it's a practice. It is not, it is a practice.
I need to work on that.
It is not easy, especially for those of us at the intersections who are oppressed, because the rest of the world, the systems around us are based in colonization and white supremacy and puritanical ideas, and that is a constant in our lives. And for, I think, almost anybody in this room, no matter what racial background, what color, queerness, whatever, if you're in this room, those systems have affected you in a way that feels heavy sometimes. But a part of what has always had all of us as people of indigenous cultures or people who have survived through colonization, slavery, forced migration, all of that, is that we've always found a resilience and a resistance in our joy. No matter how many times they try and smash us into the ground, we grow something new and something more beautiful, especially queerness and brownness and blackness. Like, we just keep making it cuter. When I think you took that idea, you assimilated it, fine, then that's out for us. Okay, we're gonna come up with something else. You know what I'm saying? Like, and we do that over and over and over again. And we find love with each other. And in this toxic system, that all of us are here and are able to find laughter, joy, love, create families, all of that, that's how I center our joy. Like, we've been doing that for generations. That's our fucking superpower.
All right, John, we can't really do this all day, and I will not.
This is, I think, like, people are starting to tell me to wrap up. And so I want to, you know,
yes,
you're
right.
Grounding in the space, and I said something similar during the LGBTQ actor panel yesterday, of like, a lot of people have been, you know, talking about boycotting Florida and don't come to Florida, forget me there. I'm like, a lot of black and queer and brown and indigenous people in Florida that like need you in this moment. And I asked people at the end of that panel to send out a message of joy and resilience and resistance to all of the young people fighting back in their schools against the Don't Say Gay bill. Because when I tell you, these kids are fighting and will win. We will win. The victory is all in ours. Yes. So we got gay prom tonight, but I wanted to know if everyone here could just leave a quick message of joy and affirmation to the young people in Florida, across the country, across the continent, across the world, who are standing up and fighting and demanding their place in the world. So I'm gonna pass it down.
Keep fighting. Keep fighting. They've already lost the culture war. They know that already. They're eventually going to pass on and cross over, and you will be the people who are left seeding the ground for what is to come. And just know that you will outlive them. And just keep holding fast and keep fighting. And know that your joy and your fabulousness and the way that we glitter and sparkle more than they often ever could is a part of what makes you magic. Your queerness.
actually help our queer friends, because it's not just their issue, it's our issue. I always tell people that I personally believe that we sincerely are stronger in numbers and we are better together, like truly. And so I think, especially in California, I've definitely seen some people be like, okay, well, that's just their thing in Florida. We're good over here. We're diverse, da, da, da. But it's only a matter of time before that type of message can definitely spread everywhere. So I would just encourage even those who may not entirely fit the description to actually go out there and help our friends. Because without that, I feel like something like this can just continue and be just like even far more damaging. So I do believe that it actually will reverse and be exactly where it needs to be, but it's not going to be there until we continue to fight.
My major thing is that you're just not alone. Like, there's a whole community. Look at us, we're all here. There's people from all over the world. And we can also, as a panel, as these people, help bring that information out. Like you were saying, policy follows culture change. That's how change happens. Change does happen on the streets. Change does happen on the ground. Now on the internet as well. So the more we keep on pushing, the more policy will follow, because that's how all laws are essentially made eventually. In the words of Motherland, the storm of fury, for sure. Incredible beings, and
all so much. Everyone, can we please get a round of applause? Outside of just these spaces. And thank you all again.